Now that we have answered the two most basic questions, that is, what is motion and what is body at rest, let us move ahead and understand what are the different types of quantities we are going to study in this chapter. So all the quantities which we are going to study will be classified in two types. Either they will be scalar quantity or they will be vector quantity. So now what is the meaning of scalar and vector quantity? So remember, any quantity that we talk about will always have a magnitude which we can term as the value of that thing, and along with that it may or may not have the direction with it. So that means any quantity is supposed to have two components related to it, the magnitude, which means value, and the direction. Now if a quantity has only magnitude and no direction, we can consider that quantity to be a scalar quantity. And that quantity which has a magnitude as well as a direction, or we can say which needs a magnitude as well as a direction, is called as a vector quantity. Let us consider a few examples. Let's say my height is 6 feet. So 6 out here, 6 feet out here is the value of my height. It's the magnitude. But do I need to give the direction in which my height is growing? The answer is no. That means those quantities which require only magnitude, only value, are considered to be scalar quantity. So height is a part of length, so we can say that length is a scalar quantity. Let's talk about mass. Consider that my mass is 60 kg. Now when I specify the mass 60 kg, do I need to specify a direction associated to it? I think the answer is no. Once again, we only need to specify the value. So that means mass is also a scalar quantity. Let's say you go to a shop and ask for 2 liters of milk. So 2 liters out here will constitute the value, that means the magnitude. But do you need to specify the direction in which the milk is going to be poured into the bag? Once again, the answer is no. That means liters, that means volume, is also an example of scalar quantity. So I think by now you are completely aware of what is a scalar quantity. So those quantities which require only magnitude and no direction are called as scalar quantity. Examples are length, mass, volume, etc. Now moving on to the next quantity, that is vector quantity. Consider that there is an object placed in front of you and you want to bring that object into motion. So you start pushing the object. When you push, that means you are applying a force. So whatever amount of force you apply, that will be the value, that means the magnitude. But whenever we bring any body in motion, you tell me, will the direction be an integral part? Is it absolutely not required to give any sort of direction? So whenever we talk about motion, we also talk about direction. So when you push that particular object, you need to think that in which direction are you going to push it. So that means force will not only have a value or a magnitude associated with it, it will also have direction. So we can say that force is an example of vector quantity. So there are several examples of vector quantities which we are going to study in this chapter slowly and steadily. As of now, we need to know the complete bifurcation of scalar and vector. So let me repeat the definition of vector quantities. We say that those quantities which require magnitude as well as direction are called as vector quantities. Noting down the examples, when it comes to scalar quantities, the examples that we discussed were length, mass, and volume. There are a few more examples which are related to this chapter, but we cannot jump upon them right now. We will discuss them as they come. Example of vector quantity, we have discussed only one example as of now, that is force. So this simple thing, which is looking pretty silly as of now, will be very useful as we go deep into the topic. Now let us understand the different components of speed and velocity. So here we have a simple representation. Let us try to understand this. An object covers 50 meters and the time it takes to do that is 2 seconds. It covers 100 meters and the total time by then is 4 seconds. Then it covers 150 meters and the total time by then is 6 seconds. So if I want to calculate the speed, we know the formula for speed is distance upon time. So if I divide distance by time out here, 50 divided by 2, answer is 25. So the speed of the object in the first instance is 25 meters per second. If you talk about the next one, 100 meter divided by 4 second, the answer is 25 meter per second once again. And in the third instance, 150 divided by 6, the answer is once again 25. So we can see that the speed of the object is constant. Whenever the speed is constant, we call it to be uniform speed. So this is one of the component of speed, that is uniform speed. So we can say that whenever an object covers equal distance in equal interval of time, for example, the interval between these two is 2 seconds and the distance traveled is 100 minus 50, that is 50 meters. So whenever an object covers equal distance in equal intervals of time, it is said to be in uniform speed or uniform motion. Even if you check the last one, that is from 150 to 100, again for the interval of 2 seconds, 150 minus 100, it will cover 50 meters in 2 seconds once again. So whenever an object covers equal distance in equal intervals of time, it is said to be in uniform motion. Talking about the other one, here you see that in the first 50 meter, the object traveled in 2 seconds. The 100 meter mark was achieved in 5 seconds and 150 meter mark was achieved in 10 seconds. So if I want to calculate the speed once again, 50 meter in 2 seconds, 50 divided by 2 gives me 25 meter per second. Talking about 100 meter in 5 seconds, the speed is 20 meter per second, whereas here 150 meter in 10 seconds, the speed is 150 divided by 10, that is 15 meter per second. So as you can observe, the speed is varying and it is not constant. So if the speed is not constant, we call it to be non-uniform speed. So we can say that whenever an object covers unequal distances in equal intervals of time, it is said to be in non-uniform motion. So here, these are the two important components of speed. But these two components can also be related with velocity. So even velocity can be uniform velocity and non-uniform velocity. If instead of distance, we had displacement out here and the body would have covered equal displacement in equal time, then we could have considered it to be uniform velocity or maybe in the other case as non-uniform velocity. So the definition will change just by a little bit. Let us once again understand the definition of uniform and non-uniform speed. So we say that whenever an object travels equal distances in equal intervals of time, it is called as uniform speed. And whenever an object covers unequal distances in equal intervals of time, it is called as non-uniform speed. Now, if I bring in components of velocity, the definition will change. We have to only add the word direction out there. So I'll say whenever an object covers equal distances in a particular direction, in equal interval of time, it is called as uniform velocity. I hope you notice the word in a particular direction. Similarly out here, whenever an object covers unequal distances in a particular direction, in equal intervals of time, it is called as non-uniform velocity. So these are two of the very important components related to speed, that is uniform speed and non-uniform speed, and related to velocity, that is uniform velocity and non-uniform velocity. Moving ahead, we realize that speed and velocity are somehow dependent on each other. So we need to know what are the effects of speed and direction on velocity. So here we are going to consider three different cases. Case one, if we change the speed but keep the direction as constant. Case 2, if the direction is changed and we keep the speed as constant. And case 3, if we change both, that is the direction as well as the speed. Let us consider all these three cases with the help of a particular example. Let's say a motorbike is going on a straight road which is about to take a turn after some time. So we say that a motorcycle on a straight road can change its speed. It can increase the speed, it can decrease the speed. So on the speedometer of the motorcycle, the velocity of the object at that instant will be shown. So if you increase the speed of the motorcycle, you can observe that the reading on the speedometer will change. So that means if you don't change the direction, but you change the speed, the velocity of the object will change. So we can say that if there is a change in the speed, there will be a change in the velocity. case two, as you see, the direction is going to be changed, but the speed will remain constant. Now, suppose there is a slight turn on that same road. You can surely maintain same speed. That means you will not give more acceleration or less acceleration. You will give the same amount of acceleration, but you will bend a little bit to take a turn. So when you do that, you realize that the speedometer varies slightly. And if it varies slightly, it means the velocity is changing. So we can understand that even if we keep the speed as constant, but we try to change the direction a little bit, there will be a change in velocity. So from the first two points, we realize that if we change the speed of the object, its velocity changes. If we change the direction of the object, its velocity changes. Now let us try the third and the most obvious one. What happens if we change both the speed as well as the direction? So it is quite obvious that if you change the speed, that means you are taking a turn and changing the speed as well. So we know that while taking a turn, if you increase or decrease the speed, the reading on the speedometer will change accordingly. So we know that if this happens, there will again be a change in velocity. So that means velocity will change if there is a change in the speed, if there is a change in the direction, or if there is a change in both of them. Unless both of them remain constant, that means there is no change in speed, there is no change in direction, only then the velocity will remain constant. So these are the effects of speed and direction on velocity. Now, along with these two components that we have studied, that is uniform speed and velocity and non-uniform speed and velocity, we move ahead and understand few more components, that is average speed and velocity and instantaneous speed and velocity. To understand the concept of average speed and velocity, let us consider a very simple example. Let's say that you have to make a journey towards your native place. Currently, you are at your home. So that means you will, once you are done packing with all your stuff, you will get down from your building. So when you get down from your building, you are covering some distance in some time at some speed. Once you get down, let's say you might take a cab towards the railway station. When you get inside the cab, the distance traveled is by the cab, and so the speed will be taken of the cab. Once you reach the station and you alight in the train, the speed of train will be considered till you reach your native place. So that means if I consider entire motion from your house till your native place, different speed was involved. First, when you got down from the building, it was your speed. Then when you took the cab, it was the speed of the cab. And finally, when you took the train, it was the speed of the train. So in such cases, we cannot pinpoint the exact speed. So we always go for the concept of average speed. Same applies for displacement. That means if we are considering displacement, we will go for the concept of average velocity. So to find average speed or average velocity, either we keep a track of all possible speeds that were taken throughout the journey, which is next to impossible. And so we go in a different manner altogether. We say that average speed is always equal to the total distance traveled by the object divided by the total time of the journey. That means from your house till your native place, the total distance will be considered, and right from your house till your native place, whatever time you have taken will be considered. That will give us the average speed. So we can say that average speed is always equal to total distance divided by total time. Similarly, if I talk about average velocity, as we just discussed, in that case, instead of distance, we will have displacement. So we will say it is defined as total displacement upon total time. Now we have the concept of instantaneous speed or velocity. I'm sure you are aware of the speedometer present in a car or in a bike. When you are traveling in a car or a bike, the speedometer shows you the speed of the vehicle at that instant. It is not going to show you the speed which you were traveling 5 minutes earlier. It will always show you the speed whatever is happening at that very instant. So such speed, which is giving you instantly the value of your speed at any given time, is called as instantaneous speed. And when you talk about the concept of velocity, it will be called as instantaneous velocity. So there is no particular formula for instantaneous speed or velocity. You just have to understand the definition, that is the speed or the velocity of an object in motion at a given instant is called as instantaneous speed or velocity. So these are the different components of speed and velocity which we have learned. Going through all of them once, the concept we started in the beginning was uniform and non-uniform speed or velocity. We then understood average speed or velocity, and then we understood instantaneous speed or velocity. If all these concepts are clear, it will help us in solving challenging questions in this chapter.